Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Sequential Devices in PLDs. Okay, so before we actually do the VHDL description for some of the sequential devices we've discussed thus far in this unit, let's go ahead and figure out where they are inside a modern programmable logic device, and that device is what's known as an FPGA, a field programmable gate array. This is a totally simplified, totally inaccurate description of a basic element within an FPGA, a cell. When I say simplified and totally inaccurate, I don't have time to do all this, okay? For our intents and purposes, we can go ahead and use a simplified model, and neither do you. You don't have enough time to look through all this because there's a bunch of other things in there not necessarily relevant to what we're going to talk about. So let's go ahead and use this simplified version. Well, the simplified version is here is this. There's a lookup table and a D flip-flop. What's the thing in the middle? Don't worry about it. What it is, it's carry generation and propagation logic, which is passing things to the thing above it and things to the thing below it. What are the things above and below? Other cells. What's it passing back and forth? Data. So what you can do is potentially hook these cells to other cells and form these increasingly larger and more complex logical functions. But the thing I want to talk about right now is the lookup table and the D flip-flop. Okay, the lookup table. The lookup table is the change in architecture that distinguishes the FPGA from its predecessor, the CPLD, complex programmable logic device. Complex programmable logic device, it really is logic gates. It really is a bunch of ANDs feeding an OR if you wanted to go ahead and do an SOP expression. And around about the late 1980s, early 1990s, you know, kind of as the mullet was doing its decline, they came up with this radically new architecture to go ahead and do a programmable logic device that's known as an FPGA. And the element that distinguishes it from a CPLD is obviously the lookup table. What a lookup table is, it's memory locations. These are, I'm trying to describe it as memory cells where you can input a truth table. And then what you do is you take a multiplexer or a data selector. If you don't know what a multiplexer or a data selector is, definitely go back and hit the common functions, combinational logic. And I've got a selector which can select a certain memory cell location, which I've happened to put the truth table into. If my selection is my input bits, it will select the part of the truth table that goes ahead and implements the combinational logic that I want. And I can either bypass my register and have just combinational logic output, or enter registered operation, i.e. use the sequential device. In this particular case, it's a D flip-flop. So let's go into some specifics here about the FPGAs. And this is one example of an architecture, physical arrangement. There are many other types, but again, what are those elements? It's a lookup table and a D flip-flop. Okay, let's take two lookup tables and two D flip-flops. We're going to call them a slice. Take four slices. We're going to call it configurable logic block. This configurable logic blocks, you can expand them infinitely in the X direction, infinitely in the Y direction. And it's not infinite, by the way. There are a finite number, but just suffice it to say for now, there's a lot of them. This is an architecture, a physical arrangement of the Xilinx Spartan 3E FPGA, which we make use of in lab. But these CLBs are being fed by IOBs. So what is a CLB? It's a configurable logic block. And the IOBs are input-output blocks. There is logic within those IOBs, but right for right now, just think of it. It's inputs and outputs. There are other things in addition to this sea of CLBs being fed by IOBs. There is block RAM, which is memory, and some other devices like multipliers. But then there's also these DCMs, digital clock managers. So if you can imagine, there's one clock that feeds the whole chip, and it's located, let's say, up in the northeast corner. You can imagine those CLBs at the southwest would be perhaps suffering some propagation delay. So what a DCM does, it manages the clock, just makes sure that everyone's getting the same signal, that the propagation is minimized, and everybody stays in synchronization with everybody else. Let's go ahead and actually use some specific examples here. Again, this has to be specific. Where did I get this information from? It got it from the internet. Go ahead, look it up on the data sheets here. By no means am I expecting you to memorize this stuff. This is just two examples here. Okay, Xilinx. They are a manufacturer of programmable logic devices. They have a bunch of different types of FPGAs, the Artix, the Vertex, the Kinetix, and the Spartan. Okay, within the Spartan, I'm going to choose the 3E. Within the 3E family, I'm going to go ahead and choose the 500K. It's got 232 input-output blocks, and it's got 1,146 CLBs. A lot. If each CLB has four slices, there are 4,656 slices. And if each slice has two cells, which is constructed from one lookup table and one flip-flop, I've got 9,312 four-input lookup tables. I've got 9,312 D flip-flops. Like I was saying, more than enough for the R uses in this particular course. We are never going to run out of room for this. That is really how the FPGA is structured. There's an older metric sometimes used so you can compare them with older logic gates or older fixed function integrated circuits. What this is the equivalent logic cells, meaning the Spartan 3E can do the job of 10,476 logic cells. Let's just use that new metric, which I've talked about, the equivalent logic cells. Let's talk about a different FPGA, the Spartan 6. Okay, so the Spartan 6 has 14,579 equivalent logic cells. Is it a more powerful device or a less powerful device? The answer is substantially more. Okay, so let's look at how this thing is arranged. And it's still the same thing. It's a lookup table with a flip-flop. However, there's some slight variations. So the Spartan 6, there's a 16, has 1,139 CLBs, so less CLBs, but it's more powerful. How does that work? Let's check it out. There's two slices per CLB. Okay, less slices for less CLBs. I still don't understand. Well, the answer is here. Each slice has four lookup tables, and there's six input, and each slice has eight flip-flops. Okay, so bringing our total of D flip-flops to 18,224, and we've got 9,112 six input lookup tables. No wonder it's a more powerful device. Like I said, do not worry about memorizing this. I'm asking you, just this is an example, how is this particular device arranged? What I am asking you to realize that the FPGA, really what it is, the most basic element is a lookup table and a D flip-flop. Let's go ahead and actually use some of the VHDL syntax to go ahead and describe some of the sequential devices we've discussed thus far.